samples and you put them for that?
Yeah. I'm going to be third. July 3rd.
What do I took for you, Ben?
I don't know, there's one down here on July the 22nd. It's affected 8.7. Highway 14, Rad.
Number 9?
No, that's one of the random samples.
That's the random sample.
It's in your folder, there, you know? And it was taken on Highway 685.
Yeah.
685.
Can you make any comment? Number 8 and number 9, sorry. Number 9, Highway 14. Highway 14.
Before it crosses, that water bond?
Well, there's the volumes that cross 14 in the VA Rad.
Volume 8 was closed there. And volume 3, the only supposed to be fire after the volume 2.
Which number?
You only have sample 2. That's volume 8, 15, and the town of VRAD itself, you know, those streams goes into volume 3. I put some live figure, which I thought for that, and it was sample. That's on the 19.
And the live fish are on the number 16, you know, the two fish we took to the Food and Drug Administration in New Orleans. They were analyzed for multi-stream, you know. They came up with no residue.
This one that was taken on the 22nd, where was that taken?
From Highway 14?
Yeah.
No, it's, you have the location, you don't tell me.
Yes, sir.
Highway 14, you have it.
And we're on Highway 14. It's right on Highway 14 itself, right as you're getting out of ERAD going to Delcom, there's a bridge right there on the highway. We took it right there to do it.
Just outside of ERAD?
Yes, sir.
Going back east?
Going towards Delcom.
Yeah. You have, you might walk down in there?
Yeah, it's so small, I can't see it.
No.
It must be it, well.
Do this all right now, but I just need to copy it. Just 15, that's what I worked on, so volume 5, order by there. And keep on using that.
Helen, let's finish with VP first, and then we'll go to H, it's your one.
Sample number, Highway 14.
14.
H.
H. Did you take any follow-up samples to the same side?
No, sir.
Follow-up samples?
No, not that one.
No, not on that.
Unless somebody else one. Not that one. That was a random sample.
Oh, that was a random sample, yeah. And the original, the volume 2, yes. There was another, told you, follow-up sample came on that.
Right.
In other words, random sample, is that from the same site or what?
They're just different canals in the area.
Sales.
I
except this one.
Oh, this was a random title. This wasn't at the original.
This wasn't in 50. This was east of 50.
So it was out of town from 50.
Yeah.
You said it, that same day, it was off. They took the thousand times, how many, 14 times?
16.
16, one time.
14
something,
and Vermilion Parish on the 22nd, which is random sample.
It was just sample we taken out of all bodies of water that was found.
Nobody went back and took another sample.
You're talking about the Royal Canal now.
IT?
Yeah.
No, the Royal Canal, we're still in our personal.
What we did on the Royal Canal is we took the original sample from the bridge and in the midst of the fish kill, and also the sample from the discharge from the flying service. And also we collected some live fish over there, raw fish, and they came in.
And not go back to the same site.
We made a follow-up investigation a couple of days later. We had an additional call on the fish kill. It ended up being the same fish kill, but all we did at that time was do some more water quality work, DOTH, and, you know, but when we discovered it was the same fish kill, we didn't collect additional samples.
So the bar, or you had some live fish in there still.
Right.
And you were suspecting an insecticide which had been applied to the sugarcane fields. Everybody seems to have this suspicion. Why don't you send the live fish to be analyzed for the insecticide? Not chemically, for instance, the grain and the get the grain and the blood before the
I think Gary can probably answer that question. He's a little more familiar with that, why we didn't do that. There is a good reason.
Can you talk about to monitor baseline? Have baseline information on sea level cover estimates?
Yes. It's not for whatever the control or any other place and these guys over there.
Well, we don't have baseline data on sea level cover estimates, so we don't know what the normal levels are.
We could not get any fish from other sites, which is not affecting?
Well, we could, but the literature. There is a lot of debate on whether or not that would be a good indicator of the application of an organophosphate, because there are other things that inhibit the sea level cover estimates,
such as
other organic chemicals.
Such as
I don't have an
example. Compounds, not either one. The only chemicals which they do is the organophosphates. Carbamates do it, but you're inspecting and you have already indicated the name of the compound you are analyzing. More specifically, what you're analyzing.
Well, the literature, according to the literature we have, states that there's a great debate on whether or not sea level cover estimates baseline levels could be an indicator to you.
If it is too late, I agree with you, but it's not the same deal as the
So if you have some information we don't have on it, we'd be happy to look at it. We'll show the people literature that we have. But that's why we did what we did.
Yeah, we just don't have to
because of the literature that we have. And if you have some new information, please share it with us.
Also, our laboratory does not do that type of analysis.
So that's the basic
thing. Yeah.
Well, I mean, that has a, if we feel that there would be a need for that information, or if we could use it, we would contract the laboratory. Our laboratory doesn't analyze for the Asian Foss method that we contract.
I don't think there's a lot of demand for analysis. Not a lot of people doing it.
Well, that's the report you're reading from. How is that labeled? It's not no way
of canal. No, it's labeled as a 7-4 drainage canal. That is based on information we got from somebody with the drainage district in that region. But on your map, it's going to say no.
Literature
When you send the fish for chemical analysis, the lab, the whole fish or the dissection?
It's
easier some, that's some composite.
You know, I don't know what egg, but it, ours did milk.
Yes,
sir.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. What was the reason we stopped with the gills? Because organophosphorus compounds is eliminated immediately after it's gone. It's not going to stay in the fish. Unless the fish eats something which has organophosphorus compounds.
When we started pulling a fish in the fish, we were not aware of the fact that it did not bioaccumulate.
But specifically, everybody, you and the following culture have already indicated that it is an organophosphorus compound, and the name is there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, actually, Dr. Abedin, when we started looking at the fish, we were not sure what was going on. We were analyzing, I think, for 4 or 5 different suspected pesticides. So we had not yet narrowed it down to the one that we seem to be finding in most of the samples.
This was for all the DEQ samples or just this particular site?
That would be all of
them. Where do you catfish?
Is this one?
It says here there were none.
There were none. Okay, well, that's on the several fish kills that I've investigated, catfish were rare. There were a few noted here and there, but in general, they were rarely affected. Or they, you know, didn't show up. But some of the literature we have shows that they're quite a bit more tolerant to this particular compound than other species.
Got some snakes in there.
Did anybody look at those snakes? Hurdles. No analysis of that kind of
thing. No analysis. obviously, one of the things you do is you look for bullet holes in animals when you see them. And of course, we didn't see any of that.
Jackson did the inspection,
but were in there. Other than that, I'm not sure what we're going to report.
Snail, slug, worm, frog.
I'm Johnny Timmons with Agriculture Department, Boston Canal. This is where the Boston Canal is located, and I went to this Don's Marina, which is located up in Gears Place, about miles from Henry. The weather was pretty bad that day. It was thundering and lightning and starting to rain, so I wasn't able to go back up in here by boat. So I went down maybe about a half mile and took a right down a little gravel road that goes down to the dead end. And there were dead fish in those drainage canals there. And I talked to one of the farmers that was back there working one of his, working his cattle, and he told me all this drains into the Boston Canal. So that's when the sample was there. And that cane tails all the way around the canal.
Same spot?
Yes. Same location.
Are you gonna do one of yours with 3 or 5?
There's a number of cane fields on it.
Yeah, we initiated investigation on July 8th and went to the same boat launch.
July 6th?
No, we initiated investigation on July 8th. That
was
and they went out to Bobo down in the Horsemont Canal, and they observed some dead fish. It was the only species they observed was striped mullet. They did some field parameter analysis with the hydro lab unit. They had a high DO of 5.2 and a low of 4.7 oxygen. Quite adequate.
Would you consider that oxygen typical?
Yeah.
Or excessively high?
Not excessively high, but it's a tidal stream, so you get some good water coming in from Anacostia Canal and the bay. So that's probably normal.
Okay.
Time of day on getting that inspection. We start out at 10 a.m. death for at least 24 hours based on an observation with the investigator. Right now. That's the only thing that is observed. We also had the complaint observed error application to sugar cane fields in the area of parts of the fish field.
How long before?
I don't have a time period. Several days, within several days. One of the stations which had a reading on the water sample was just collected by the ag of R21 for the dairy station. This is a stream which is probably 25 yards wide, 50 yards. It's probably in the 8-foot area. Drift channel.
You might want to add to the random sampling. Taking 14 samples that day, and 12 of the random samples was taken around the Boston Canal area, which I'm sure you like the results of.
Yeah, that's the one had to say you had the 8-hole for that
Yeah, that was part of the random sampling, didn't it?
Did some of the other samples show problems?
No.
Just one.
Show me. Show me where you took the sample. Where you took the sample from?
For the Boston Canal?
Yeah.
I have to see something. The gravel road. The cane field and this time. The drainage ditch. The ground bottom on it.
Which way did that normally flow?
The main angle. This would be south.
South?
Well, we're going well, it was flowing this way towards the way the Boston Canal area and whichever direction that was in.
It's power there, so
this one here was taken in the Boston Canal itself. The sample that he took was the drainage canal and drained it.
Yes.
bridge, right as you get out of here, right on the bridge, no, on the main highway.
Looks like we're going to go like this till the end of the evening, and if we have any questions, also DEQ are going to present the same thing that have already done, and the Department of Agriculture are going to do the same thing they have already done. If we have any questions in general and specific to those people who are here, we can do it now, and I suggest that we will go over the numbers by ourselves, because we wanted just a sample of the sampling, methodology, preservation, etc. And I have a couple of questions for those lab people after we finish with the inspectors. I any general questions or specific questions? If you agree, we can continue the study processing of the numbers on our own without having the rest tying up everybody in here to stay as long as we have heard samples of what they have done. I don't think it's necessary to keep them over here unless you feel that the contrary. Except the lab people, we have a couple of questions about the
report. One thing I'm having comments on, like, is that something that I'm going to have to answer?
Yeah. Anything you want to add before?
I think the only thing that I haven't covered yet was our fish kill investigation procedures.
Just go ahead.
Okay.
Is that fair with everybody? So I don't want to keep everybody tied up for the same thing. We're going to repeat what they have done. It looks like the procedure is the same for everybody. Mm-hmm. And for each department. Go ahead.
We have been the agency to investigate fish kills since my career began 17 years ago. Water Pollution Control, in fact, was part of Wildlife and Fisheries at one time. We normally get our reports of fish kills from our 24-hour hotline through Baton Rouge. Citizens call that hotline. Agencies call the hotline. They are referred to the regional office. We also get numerous fish kill reports coming in from citizens directly to our office by radio, from Wildlife and Fisheries game agents, etc. Just coming from all over. Our usual procedure is to proceed to the area in question. Each of our vehicles are equipped with full complements of equipment. In fact, we have pictures of a typical vehicle with equipment, should you like to see that. All of our field people have equipment such as this. Most important is the water quality measuring devices. Most of us have hydrolabs. Some have hydrolabs with Mark 10 instruments. A hydrolab is a multi-probe instrument that measures dissolved oxygen, pH, temperature, conductivity, and depth, probe depth. So you can detect how deep your sample is being measured. We normally measure. We normally measure at multiple depths. Many of our fish kills in Louisiana are DO related. It's because of the types of drainage South Louisiana receives. Swamp drainage is very typically extremely low in dissolved oxygen. Swamp drainage is typically very clear black water, typically low in oxygen, low in pH. Yet they are full of fishes. Those fishes are acclimated to those conditions. Speculation here, but I would imagine if you run hemoglobin content, it would be much higher than a fish from northern United States, from some babbling brook, possibly. The fish kill investigation usually begins with just a run-through to look at the extent. Just get an idea of where it starts, where it ends. Anything going on in the area, observations are made, just observations running through the site. Extensive use of citizenry interviews is done, because of course we're there at the time the fish are dead. Whatever killed them, of course, happened earlier. We're trying to get that information. We use bridge tenders who are on site. Those are really good people to talk to. Pump operators, people such as that, citizens living along the bank. Prime importance in fish kill investigation is observations of the species killed. Normally a DO cause can be separated from other causes very easily, either by direct measurement. However, we realize that the direct measurement at the time we are there, the fish had died early in most cases. Most cases we are there several days after the fish kill. Sometimes we're there during the fish kill. However, the species of fish kill give a lot of clues. There is a physiological difference, as probably I'm sure several of you know, between a term physoclistic fishes, which are fishes which are normal, bass, bluegills, primarily upon water column concentrations of dissolved oxygen, as opposed to the other groups of fishes known as physostomic fishes. Those fishes, which are garfish and the bowfin, have a connection between their pharynx and their gas bladder. And those fishes, the gas bladder is very highly vascularized, and it basically looks very similar to a lung. And this is why you'll see these fishes coming to the top, engulfing atmospheric oxygen. So because of those morphological differences in dissolved oxygen-related fish kill, you don't normally see garfish and bowfin, because even in low oxygen levels, they can come to the top and engulf atmospheric oxygen. This is why in many of our streams, which are typically low in dissolved oxygen, but if a garfish gets trapped in a hoop net where he can't get to the surface, he will drown. That's very common in Louisiana. So the observations, very important. Citizenry interviews, very important. We maintain a very extensive reference. Each of our regional offices has extensive reference collections. Fish keys, field manuals here. Aquatic toxicity, handbooks and textbooks and things of that nature. And at the end of the fish kill investigation course, we arrive at a most probable cause. And that is based on the observations made, the data collected, both the chemical data, laboratory data, and the on-site field data. Also, we have at our access, we have a fairly extensive water quality monitoring network over the archipelago of Louisiana. Bayou de Fouche, which is in my region, is very extensively monitored, and we have the benefit of going back period of record, sometimes 20, 30 years, on monthly samples and establishing a pattern in that stream. As I said, separation between oxygen kills, oxygen-related kills, and other kills is fairly easy. What may be more difficult in oxygen-related kills is to determine what caused the oxygen depletion. That can be very challenging. Fish kills in general are very challenging. They're technically demanding. We go through great pains to train our people to do that. It's a very highly specialized task. There's just not a lot of people doing that. And we have been the agency to investigate fish kills, and we've built up a lot of expertise over these years doing that. I can answer any specific questions on the on why the food fish kill is within my area, but I think you want to say that. I just want to go through the investigation stage.
Yes.
If you have any questions on that, we'll be here. Or anything I've said.
I just want to take the opportunity. Kerry touched this thing here. It's a new manual that's recently available to the Fish and Wildlife Service. And I've got a couple of extras here, and I meant to present one to your agency. And we'll see who is Grundy. Yes, Grundy. There seems to have been a great deal of interest in that document recently. You can't keep
it's time
it.
Limit, isn't it?
Yes, very much so.
Wait, one more?
Yes. Keep going.
Sorry. I was criticized one of my colleagues told me to keep it short. Say no. It's very unusual for a characteristic, clinical characteristic, to be observed a fish and be able to point to a specific cause. In fact, this was not something that we generally knew until this document came out, until we obtained a copy. But the forward orientation of the pectoral fins, which would have had that characteristic many years ago. When I first started, we frequently had mortalities that we felt were related to organophosphate poisoning, and we have not seen that in many years. And since we've had access to this publication, and
follow up to what you're indicating there too, there's a lot of the things that were requested, like you indicated earlier about the acetyl coal escalation, all this, as this whole process has been very educational for me too, and what I'm finding out is that one or two of these things are not going to tell you, yes, this is definitely this, and that's not.
Exactly.
But you start looking at the whole gamut of different parameters you can look at, physiological, infectious agents, what have you. They're going to start to give you a good picture of what's really going on. So one of these little things may not be important, but the overall thing is very important to look at all of them.
It's very, very much akin to a detective work. Biological chemical detection.
Since you have been investigating fish people, on the average, how many have you been? They are 4 per year, more in the summer? Could you describe a little bit the patterns?
Yeah, I'd say the pattern is of many more fish kills during the summer months. That is the pattern.
What's the cause? Your most probable cause, how do they distribute? Usually
it's dissolved oxygen related. Now, the cause of dissolved oxygen depletion varies. We have had fish kills caused by ingestion of red ants, buckfish, over ingestion of red ants. We've had fish kills caused by dynamite, seismic testing. We have fish kills caused by release of food preservatives, sulfites, which we know it is a dissolved oxygen depletion, but we can't measure sulfite because now it's sulfates. Sulfates are natural in the environment. But we suspect that because of the observations we make around the kill. For instance, we know in this particular case that shrimpers use sulfites, bisulfites, as an antioxidant. A little bit is good, so a lot must be really good. So they overuse it, tend to overuse it, get back to the dock, and they dump it all out, and we get oxygen depletion. But that's where the observations of the whole picture come in. It's a trawling season. The shrimp is there. So we have to make a conclusion as the most probable cause. We didn't measure sulfite, but it can't be measured. It's sulfate immediately, which is similar to the organophosphate problem. We have a lot of trouble measuring that. By the fish, we collected fish, because my experience has been that it's been very difficult in the early years of my career to detect any more. I realize now that the detection limits back in those early days were much less than they are now, or much, much greater than they are now. We didn't even have the use of mass specs back then. We did now. In retrospect, I certainly wish I would have collected some of my watch then. Fish, of course, came up negative. Detection limits of fish tissue were much greater.
One of the things that causes us great concern is when you have something that is pesticide related, we also need to be involved. We are the agency that's responsible for the protection of the natural resources of this state. We take it seriously, and we intend to keep taking it seriously. And so we would urge everybody, I don't really quite know what the limit of your charge is, but I think that certainly that it's imperative that people have proper support, they have proper training, and that they have proper equipment so that when they go out, they can do their jobs, and so that there is a sharing of information. And we very much look forward to that day coming in Louisiana.
Anybody else wants to say anything? Something? Anything? Just... So, that's it? I just want to keep the... free to leave if you want to, except that Penelope will have a couple of questions if the panel must. Well, probably ask a couple of questions about the methods of analysis.
I'd like to say something.
Yes, please.
You mentioned the cholinesterase inhibitor.
Yes.
Years ago, that was done routinely, but it's not done anymore.
We're still doing
it. By our laboratory.
We're still doing it. Our graduate students are so good and it's so cheap.
Uh-huh.
long as it is as it's fresh, it is very indicative. Because this is, you see, as soon as the fish dies, you can flip over and go on your tongue. We're doing this also with people. We still don't have any people.
Thank you. 2010 on the 8th of August 1991. Arcadian chemicals, heavy, heavy, heavy odor of like an ammonia. Real, I mean, it smelled, if I had a bottle up here and I'm sniffing it, it smelled that strong of the household brand. It's tough. Over here, across the street, I don't know if I can shoot them. I don't know, but there's cattle right over there. See them? I don't know if you can see them or not. A lot of cattle. Just breathing this up. Let's see if we can get some over here. There they are. It's crazy.
move one way or the other? I thought you wanted the Four Horsemen of Apocalypse rides again.
Couldn't take
you
that shot.
You want it out there?
Nah, don't worry about it. It's running, so you've done this so many times before.
Oh, God.
Well, what can you say? Just go ahead and start.
Let's think of something. God, it's running. Quick, stop it.
I'll stop.
I
should have brought my remote. Ready?
Mention the name, John?
No, just the
this
groove
hasn't been
bar.
This running this whole time with
no.
Jimmy Javin.
No, okay. I just cranked it up now.
Okay.
We could always. Well, we can't look at this. But anyway, go ahead.
Okay, what am I going to say?
I'm going to leave.
I feel stupid. I usually have a reporter at least asking me a question.
I know, you did
I've
that
never,
so well
before. I've never, like, free-thought it before. This is, like, free thought. I just, like, think of what I'm going to do. Okay, now, stop for a minute. Now. We're going to meditate. I feel like the chicken, the rooster.
You're rolling.
Oh, no, really. Oh, wait, okay. The thing's on in the back.
Go ahead.
Okay. Let's try. You sure you can't edit this together?
Sure, I can.
This is gonna make. I gotta wait. Stop this thing, Patrick! How do I stop it?
Somebody stop this crazy thing!
Yeah, how do you stop it so I can know, just in case it runs away with itself?
There's a little red button.
Right here?
That one you can hit too. Rock, go with it.
Oh, cool. Forget I'm here. Okay. This is serious. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, what are we gonna say?
Hi.
You can be the reporter. Okay, let's pretend like you're Mr. Hope. Okay, pretend like you're Mr. Hope. Okay.
So talk to me.
Okay. Hello, Mr. Hope. My name is Mary Lee Orr. I'm director of Louisiana Environmental Action Network. Our citizens suffer... Wait a minute. Okay. Can I, you could put this in front of me and read it?
Sure,
okay.
Sure.
Okay. Hello, Mr. Hope. My name is Mary Lee Orr. I'm director of Louisiana Environmental Action Network. Our citizens in Louisiana suffer more toxics per square mile and per capita than any other state in the nation. We are home to 664 abandoned hazardous waste sites, 12,000 identified oil field waste pits, 5,000 identified oil field injection pits. Shit, let me start again. That's too many big words. Can we use this part? We need help on brain damage from the chemicals.
Okay, go ahead.
What?
You do so well out in front of those cameras. What's wrong with this one?
I know, because it's different, because you're asking me a question that I can just answer. I don't know 664 waste bits or whatever. Okay. So we'll just read it, and it's going to be okay. We're going to start again. Don't worry. I'm going to be all right. Okay?
Oh, I never doubted you for a moment.
Okay. Hello, Mr. Hope. My name is Mary Lee Orr. I'm director of Louisiana Environmental Action Network. Our citizens in Louisiana suffer more toxics per square mile and per capita than any other state in the nation. We're home to 664 abandoned hazardous waste sites, 12,000 identified oil field waste pits, 5,000 identified oil field injection wells, and 43 hazardous waste injection wells. We suffer from some of the highest cancer rates in the United States. That is the bad news, but the good news is that the people of Louisiana are fighting to clean up our air, land, and water. And with your help, we can empower more people than ever before in our history. We hope with this video we'll share with you what's happening to the people of Louisiana. We need your help. Thank you. And thank you, Brooke, for giving us this your attention. Maybe I need to change the end. I'm sorry. I have to edit it different. I don't know.
That's fine.
It's okay. We need to try again, I think. Want to do part of it over?
Now do it without the sheet.
The heart?
No. Just say what you want to say. Just tell them, look, it's pretty bad down here, whatever. What's wrong with the chemical corridor? Hi, Brooke.
Or, hi, Brooke.
You know, I'll ask you the question, and then you say, hello, who is it? Mr. Holt.
Wait a minute. Okay, yeah, we can just talk. Okay, we're just talking, edit together, okay? Hi,
yeah.
Mr. Holt, my name is Mary Lee Orr. I'm director of Louisiana Environmental Action Network. Louisiana is number two in the overall absorption of toxics to our air, land, and water. We suffer from some of the highest cancer rates in the country. I've seen people, community people and workers, suffer from cancer and other illnesses due to the result of their exposure. We need your help. We hope this video will share with you what is happening to the people of Louisiana. We hope you will share the vision that you will come down here and lend a hand to help save the natural resources and the people of Louisiana.
Thank you for your help.
Freeport and Texarkana join forces tonight in the first ever forum of the Northwest Louisiana Environmental Coalition. The meeting was organized by Jeanette Tate, who first became involved in environmental issues during the investigation into possible toxic fumes at the Alexis Park Apartments. Don Preston was one of four from Texarkana who made the trip to Shreveport to tell his story of the fight to relocate families that bought homes that were built on an old creosote plant near Carver Terrace.
About when this problem first came to the attention of the environmentalists, we got things from the 6th EPA region that says, you can just forget about buying out because this is completely out of the question. They didn't say this once. They said it a million times. You can forget this. They just got downright ugly. But I want you to know that Carver Terrace right now is in the process of moving to the appraisals being made on the homes to move 252 people off of that site.
In 1986, the EPA tested the Alexis Park area, and they found high levels of hydrocarbons. They also found lead as high as 6,980 parts per million. They recommended that the area be covered and monitored, covered with 2 feet of dirt and monitored. But there's nothing in the records that shows that this was done.
Mary Lee Orr, who heads a similar environmental group in Baton Rouge, moderated tonight's meeting. The goal of the coalition is to unite with other environmental groups to keep pollution problems in front of the public and to force companies to clean up their toxic waste.
Methane gas in local apartments, creosote in a Texarkana neighborhood, hazardous wastes of all kinds in a dump in Ida. It seems we're surrounded by dangerous chemicals. The Northwest Louisiana Environmental Coalition wants to raise awareness of environmental problems in the area, and they held a meeting tonight. Mary Lee Orr is the executive director of the Louisiana Environmental Action Network in Baton Rouge. She's with us now. Mary Lee, thanks for being here.
Thanks for inviting me.
Is there as much dangerous stuff out there as there seems to be?
Studies indicate we're 49th in environmental quality here in Louisiana. The problems are enormous. That's the bad news. But the good news is, Liz, that citizens are fighting back, that we want to clean up our air, land, and water. We truly love our state, and we know that ordinary people can make a difference. And that's what that meeting was about tonight, ordinary citizens finding their voice and wanting to make a difference here in this parish.
What can we do about it? I mean, we're going up against a big business and people with a lot of money and a lot of clout.
That's what I thought, but I've seen victories all over the states, all over the United States. We can organize, do actions. We can push what we call the lever of power by going into our voting booth and voting in those officials who truly represent us and want to protect the natural resources of the state. So there's a lot we can do, a lot we can share with one another. The resources of the people are very valuable.
You are from Baton Rouge, which is, I guess, Petrochemical Alley down there, Cancer Alley, sometimes they call it. What's the worst problem in the state?
I think everyone thinks their own is the worst problem, the one that affects their health. Of course, we're number one in the overall absorption of toxics into our water. We're number two in our overall absorption to our air, land, and water. I don't know how you equate those, Liz, really. I think the message is that we need to do something about it. That it's a critical state that we're in right now, but I feel those people that are organizing tonight feel that they can make a difference. That's the good news. We need to spread that, that people are not powerless over this issue.
You were telling me earlier, people power?
People power, yes. Together we can make a difference.
All right, Mary Lee Orr, thank you very much for being with us. I have a phone number. If people are interested,
please,
if they would like to contact you, they certainly can. The Louisiana Environmental Action Network is at area code 504-928-1315.